Sonos has raving fans. I think their company motto might actually be there are only two kinds of people on the planet. Those who love Sonos, those who've just never heard them before. Thanks for joining us today. I'm Ryan with the Help Cloud YouTube channel. I'm really excited to look at this little product right here, the Sonos Beam. We'll do a setup and review, and we'll show you why Sonos thinks that this is the right soundbar for you. So let's take a look. It's smaller, more compact, it's more affordable, and just like the Sonos One, the Beam is arguably one of the smartest soundbars on the market right now. Now, at the time of this taping, this guy resells for about $399, so $400. And when you compare that with its predecessors, Play Bar or Play Bass, each retailing for $700, this seems like a bargain, even if it's still a little bit higher priced for an entry-level soundbar. The majority of TVs today are between 50 and 55 inches and cost less than $1,000. So there's a large market that Sonos is trying to enter where people are maybe a little more frugal or don't have a lot of cash, but definitely want to upgrade from their stock TV speaker system. So that's where this guy comes in. So let's take a look. In the box, he's wrapped neatly in this little package. Pull him out. Just behind the Beam is a little accessory box. Now, as you pull that out and open it up, you'll notice there's a power cord, there's an HDMI cable, and then there's a nice little adapter that allows you to take your digital optical audio and convert it into an HDMI signal. It's really nice for those older TVs that may not have HDMI technology yet. It's really well made. When you pull it out of the box, you'll notice immediately the attention to detail. It has a fabric surround on the front that goes all the way around the sides and the back. It has a plastic composite top, but you'll also know that it has a concave top. I don't know if that was a design feature to reduce glare or if just some designer won an argument and thought it would look cool. But even in your screen right now, you can see some of that light reflecting back to you. It is a compact soundbar and smart hub. It's just about 2 feet wide. That's 25.5 inches wide. It's about 2¾ inches tall and just under 4 inches deep. It weighs about 6 pounds, 6.2 pounds to be exact. So it feels light when compared with some of the other soundbars on the market that can get up to 20, 25 pounds, and then even 30 and 40 inches wide. So this should fit nicely under any TV. Now they make it in two colors, black and white. I chose black, probably to match the color of my soul, but the white option is also a very nice color. On top are the familiar Sonos controls. On the left side, you have a little function button that's a down volume. On the right side, you have a function button that's an up volume. If you slide from left to right, that's fast forward, and from right to left, that will rewind the tracks. In the middle, you have a play pause function, and then on the back, you have a microphone mute button. So it's a very, very simple setup. Now, if you look closely, there are five far field microphones. That just means they'll pick up volume from a distance away. So you know if you're quite a ways away from your speaker, it'll still pick up that sound, especially if you're blasting music or some sort of movie sequence. You can disable that microphone. Those of you that are sensitive about data collection or data monitoring, you can turn that off. Just remember that tinfoil hats are based on science. But all joking aside, it is a really nice feature that you can mute that microphone and turn those voice assistants off for those of you who are sensitive to that. Most of you are looking at buying a smart soundbar, so maybe you don't mind having them listen in on everything you say. I don't know, it's up to you. It packs 4 full range woofers and 1 tweeter right in the center. It also has 3 passive radiators. Essentially, that means there are 3 ports that will passively move air around the soundbar to give it a little bit more bottom end oomph, a little bit more depth. The 5 active drivers are powered by Class D amplifiers. Obviously, I think they're better than A amplifiers or AB amplifiers. I don't even know what that means, but they're kind of like the Taylor Swifts of amplifiers. Either you love them or hate them. But for this unit, the D-amplifiers do a great job. Around back, you'll notice there's a power plug, an HDMI port, and an Ethernet socket, and then also a manual sync button. So it's really simple on the back. ease of setup is really important to modern day consumers, especially for soundbars. And Sonos, amongst its peers, might actually stand out as one of the easiest to set up. It's actually so easy, I'm a little hesitant to show you how to do it. But essentially, pull it out of the box, plug the power into the back, plug your HDMI cable into the back, run it to your HDMI ARC in your TV. If you're using older tech with a digital optical audio output from your TV, just use that adapter and plug it into your HDMI port and you're good to go. The last step is obviously downloading the app on your phone. So you go to your phone, download the app, create your user account, and voila. The Sonos Beam mandates a specific type of setup. You have to run all of your AV component HDMI cables from the components themselves to the TV, and then run a single HDMI ARC from your TV to the Beam itself. Now, that's where HDMI ARC becomes so important. That ARC stands for audio return channel, and essentially it takes what an HDMI cable is, which is basically a one-way street for data to go down, and turns it into a two-way street where both devices can communicate back and forth. It's really convenient with modern-day smart TVs that have streaming services like Hulu or Prime or Netflix or any of the myriad that are popping up nowadays. So that's why HDMI ARC is so important. So put away that digital optical audio cable. So back to setup. The next thing you'll wanna do is with your phone, you're gonna download the app, create a user account, open up your app, connect this little device to your Wi-Fi, it'll find it, and then through the app, you'll be able to create a room for your Sonos device. It's that simple. Now, this is where Sonos really stands out. You can pair any of their component speakers with other speakers in a certain room, whether it's a Play 1, Play 3, Play 5. What that allows you to do is create specific rooms and control each of those rooms and the music that is playing in each of those rooms through your app. So for me, I have a Sonos One in the kitchen, a Sonos One in my bathroom, and a Sonos One in my master bedroom. The app itself is fairly easy to use. There are some people who find it annoying because it always seems like that one thing that you're looking for is hiding in some menu somewhere. But after a few minutes, I think the majority of users are going to really enjoy using it and understand it. Now, I've used a lot of different manufacturers' applications, from Sonos to Samsung to Bose, and I really like this application. I think it does a great job. So you can pair multiple speakers to this system. You can add two component rear speakers and take it from a three-channel system to a five-channel system. You could even add a subwoofer and take it to a 5.1 system. I mean, pair two of them to this little dude and see if you can blow the windows out in your house. It'd be awesome. I don't know. If it's too loud, you're probably too old. Now let's get to voice control. Voice control arguably is one of the main reasons to buy this product. It has Google Assistant and Amazon Alexa built right in, which is really nice for those of you looking to step into the voice assistant world. You won't need a separate Echo device, just the Beam. So if your TV supports CEC, Consumer Electronics Controls, then you'll be able to say things like, Alexa, turn the TV on, or Alexa, turn the volume up or down, or mute. You'll be able to throw your remote away and control your TV with your voice assistant, whether it's Alexa or Google. If you really want to expand the vocabulary of voice commands, consider getting another Amazon streaming device like the Fire Stick or the Fire Stick 4K. That unlocks the ability to have Alexa do commands such as, Alexa, play Stranger Things, and it will pick up right where you left off. You also might be able to ask Alexa for back rub. I'm just not sure if that would come through with the Fire Stick or not. For me, Alexa is about as fast as using the remote. It's just nice if I've stood up and I'm away from the TV, I can command it to pause or turn the volume up or down. Siri isn't native to the soundbar, but you can access Siri as a voice assistant with Apple's own proprietary AirPlay 2. So those are some nice features with those voice controls. Now, as far as music is concerned, how does it sound? Well, for its size, it actually sounds incredibly good. It doesn't get extremely loud, but it will fill a small to mid-size room, which is exactly what Sonos was trying to do. With directional speakers, it creates a believable three-channel system. As you're watching video or streaming, you actually really feel like objects move across the screen and across the room, so it can push sound out to the sides of the room really, really well. Now, unsurprisingly, it's never going to convince you that it is a truly surround sound. It won't even create a virtual surround sound. It just isn't capable of doing that. Those of you who are heavy video watchers or streamers and are looking to the future of music formats or cinematic formats like Dolby Atmos or DTSX, you're gonna have to look elsewhere because this little guy doesn't support either of those codecs. It just can't push volume up and over your head or around the room. But it does a really nice job of filling up the front space and creating some good atmospheric effects. Now, when you pair this with two component speakers in the rear, whether it's a Play 1 or 3 or 5 or just some component Sonos speaker, this little bugger will stand toe-to-toe with any other soundbar in its market in its price range. It just really performs well. And you'll feel that when you watch a sporting event, you feel like you're in the stadium, the applause are all around you, or you're watching a really good 4K video. Now, because the speakers are directional and this is an AV unit first, when you're listening to music, it feels more like a simulated stereo experience. You're never really gonna be fooled into believing that you have a two or a three channel separated stereo system. But bear in mind, for its size, the music quality is great. It has great tonal quality, has good weight to the bass, great punch and great rhythm. It does a great job with mid and low frequencies. Those three passive radiators that help move that sound around actually really give it that lower end oomph that other soundbars can't produce as well. One drawback to the sound is there can be a little bit of some treble brightness. And at higher volumes, the sound becomes a little bit harsh, but that's really only when you're kicking this system hard. Now, the Sonos Beam has a limited range of audio codecs that it supports. It's got stereo PCM, Dolby, Dolby Digital, Dolby Digital 5.1, etc., but it doesn't have DTS or lossless support. So that might be a deal breaker for some of you out there. If you really are an audiophile, you're probably not shopping for a compact soundbar anyway. But again, for your average everyday consumer, where this is more of a plug and play, the sound quality is really great and I honestly like it. The Sonos Beam has an enhanced sound mode and that allows you to select that and focus the tonal quality on dialogue heavy TV or even bring the dialogue a little bit more forward in movies and loud sequences. And it does make a small difference with this guy. And so most of the time, I actually found myself leaving that on. Sonos has a true play tuning system. What that means is after you install this, you can use an Apple iOS device's microphone to tune the system into your room. So specifically, if I put this in my living room, I walk around with the microphone held up and it pings sounds off the different surfaces in my room. And that microphone picks them up and adjusts the speaker's performance based off of latency between those different points. So with its predecessors, like the Sonos Play Bass and Play Bar, it made a big difference. With this one, I didn't notice a difference as much. But bear in mind, if you add component speakers, you'll definitely want to do this. And then once the system is broken in, you're going to want to retune it just to make sure that you're getting the best audio performance in your room. TruePlay Tune only works with an Apple iOS device. So if you're an Android user, you're kind of out of luck. You're either going to have to beg, bribe, or steal a phone from a friend and then tune it. It supports all sorts of streaming services. You can access them through your app or AirPlay them through your iOS enabled device. Either way, you're gonna get Google Play, Deezer, Amazon Music, Spotify, Apple Music, basically internet radio, and 85 billion other streaming services as they become available. There are some drawbacks to this little guy, and one of them is that it's not Bluetooth compatible. A lot of people argue that AirPlay 2 takes its place, and some people don't really like Bluetooth in general, but that's something to bear in mind that you cannot Bluetooth connect to this. You have to go through the Wi-Fi system. Next, most people don't consider their TV a pass-through device. What that means is where all of your AV components are gonna be run into your TV directly, you're gonna have to drag them all up into your TV, which can be a bit of a pain if it's a wall-mounted TV. And then you're gonna have to run one HDMI ARC back to the Sonos Beam. Now, the mounting issues aside, the bigger problem can arise with your TV acting as a pass-through device. It's only gonna be as fast as your television's processor passing that through into the soundbar itself. So that's where you're gonna get some of those latency issues and voice issues not actually matching what's happening on the screen. And unfortunately, the way this is designed, there's no way around that. So that's one of the complaints about this system, is just one HDMI port. If it were like some of its higher end products, there would be more ports and the soundbar itself would be your 4K pass-through device. What are the pros? Now, obviously, Alexa and Google Assistant baked right in are big pros. Having an HDMI ARC finally in a Sonos product is a huge plus. They've been behind the curve on this for years now, and they finally answered it with this product. This is an affordable soundbar that will definitely transform the sound of your room, especially when compared with your stock TV speaker system. Its small size means you can place it anywhere and you'll immediately notice an impact. It's also affordable enough that if you do decide to purchase it, it's not gonna break your budget, so you're not gonna have to go to the bank and take out a second mortgage just to get an upgrade in your sound system. It's a perfect family speaker for those who watch a lot of TV or movies and yet occasionally want to appreciate a good music sound. This soundbar hits all of that. It has great versatility, great sound reproduction, and can really do well in a lot of different settings. Out of the box, it's sexy. You can place it in front of your TV or wall mount it and feel proud of this product. Two, it's really easy to set up. And then three, it sounds really good. For a compact, smart hub / soundbar, this hits all of the marks for me, and I think it might be one of the best soundbars for an entry-level consumer. So that's it. Thanks for watching. If you liked the video, hit the subscribe button, hit the bell, leave your comments below, let us know what you think. I hope this was helpful, and have a great day.